My name is Lawrence Alexander, Chancellor of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. In 1890, public land-grant university. I'm very pleased to formally open the public meeting of the Board for International Food and Agricultural Development, BIFAD. Thanks to those in the room for joining us in person early in the morning for this meeting on a topic of exceptional importance. We're also joined by a large online audience, which is more than 550 registrants from 63 countries and over 400 different organizations. Your participation in today's event will certainly enrich the discussion and inform the board's work. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge other distinguished guests in today's meeting, including Ambassador Kenneth Quinn, President Emeritus of the World Food Prize Foundation, Dr. Lawrence Haddad, the 2018 World Food Prize Laureate, Dr. Howeth Buis, 2016 World Food Prize Laureate. I am honored to serve as chair of BIFAD. We're a 7-member presidentially appointed advisory board to USAID, established to ensure that USAID brings the assets of U.S. universities to bear on developmental challenges in agriculture, nutrition, and food security. I'd like to give my fellow BIFAD members in the room a minute to introduce themselves in this order: Kathy Spann, Ratan Lal, and Sawita Liverpool-Tassi.
Good morning, morning warriors. I'm Kathy Spann. In addition to the privilege of serving on BIFAD, I am the president and CEO of Helen Keller International. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Ratan Lal. I'm professor of soil science at Ohio State University and director of the Carbon Management and Sequestration Center. I have worked in Africa for about 20 years, and in Australia and in Asia. And I have finally worked at Ohio State teaching soil and climate and soil carbon sequestration for food and climate security. I've been there for 35 years. It's a pleasure to be with BAF by far.
Good morning. I'm Sawita Liverpool-Tassi. I'm an MSU Foundation professor in the Department of Agricultural, Food, and Resource Economics. And my work spans understanding Africa's food systems transformation and the opportunities it creates for rural and urban households. It's great to be here, and thank you for coming.
Thank you. Three of our members are participating virtually today, and I will mention them in by way of introduction. Henri Moore is Vice President, Head of Responsible Business for Halion Group. Pamela Anderson is Director General Emerita of the International Potato Center. And Marie Boyd is Associate Professor at the University of South Carolina School of Law. I want to note that BIFAD, as a federal advisory committee, includes public comment periods in its public meetings. This is a valuable opportunity for the board to hear directly from stakeholders on the issues at hand. We invite the participants to ask questions during the Q&A later in this session, and for our virtual audience to share ideas in the chat box and put forward questions using the Q&A box for the speaker and panelists to address later in this morning's session. We also look forward to posting official minutes of these proceedings on USAID's BIFAD website following this event. Today's meeting, titled Fed to Thrive, is intended to share the most current evidence around improving the affordability of safe, nutritious foods among children 6 to 23 months old. We know that nutrition is foundational to development, and that ensuring safe and affordable nutrition is one of the most cost-effective ways to save lives and to achieve other global development goals. We also know that ensuring good nutrition requires the coordinated effort of multiple sectors, including health, agriculture and food systems, water, humanitarian relief, and resilience. As we begin discussion today, I would like to reflect on the theme of this year's World Food Prize, Feeding a Fragile World, which recognizes the pervasive shocks to the global food system and the compounding effects of conflict, climate change, and COVID-19. This week's gatherings are rooted in hope and focused on action. So in that spirit, BIFAD aims for our work to inform a cross-sectional, whole-of-agency approach. And with that introduction, I am honored to welcome to the podium BIFAD member Kathy Spahn, a dedicated champion for health and nutrition. Her leadership and vision were central to bringing together this program and panel of speakers. Thank you, Kathy. Let's welcome her.
Thanks, and good morning again. It's really a privilege to be here among such a distinguished audience, both here and virtually. You likely are all too familiar with the grim statistics. More than 45 million children under the age of 5 suffer from wasting around the world. To put that in a way that's perhaps easier to grasp, each year, malnutrition kills more children than AIDS, TB, malaria, and now COVID combined. That's kind of a staggering thought. Malnutrition is the cause of nearly half of all child deaths in the world. So simply put, the world has failed to improve the way that most children are fed. And the problem is not a technical one. I think those of you in the room, certainly those on the panel, know that we have the solutions. They are tested, they are proven. It is really a question of political will. If kids continue to die, it's because of political will. And I have to say, we are seeing that political will emerge. I was thrilled by recent efforts to scale up wasting treatment. There was a major pledging event led by USAID Administrator Samantha Power, who helped to garner more than $500 million in new resources to combat wasting around the world. That, to me, is a major landmark occurrence. So is, or I should say will be, the passage of the Global Malnutrition Prevention and Treatment Act, which has been passed by the House and the Senate with robust bipartisan support, and it's simply awaiting some pro forma activities for President Biden to sign it into law. But that's not enough. We are not there yet. This commitment needs to be sustained, but it also needs to be broadened far beyond wasting. True success is a world where children never get to acute malnutrition in the first place, because children bear the scars of poor diets for their entire lives, and children under 2 years of age bear the highest burden of malnutrition and of mortality. It is crucial, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here, that they get the nourishing food they need at the start of their lives. How they are fed before the age of 2 sets the course for the entire rest of their lives. It shapes their growth, their learning, their development. And we are failing. Nearly 2 in 3 children, 6 months to 2 years of age, are not consuming optimally adequate diets that are critical to their growth and their development. 2 in 3 around the world. But when you focus this lens in on lower and middle income countries, depending which statistics they use, you use at best, fewer than 1 in 5 children in LMICs get a minimum acceptable diet. That is both outrageous and deeply frightening. The drivers of poor diets for these children lie beyond the control of their individual families, yet families are who are left to bear the consequences. This crisis calls for fresh thinking. It calls for some new ideas. We need to get to a place where nutritious and safe foods and essential nutrition services are available for every child in this crucial age range. We have knowledge, we have evidence of solutions that work, but we are not seeing the progress we need. In fact, we're seeing that progress escaping a bit with the triple C's that we've been talking about a lot these past couple of days. So where are we getting stuck? What can we be doing differently? And I want to stress, as Lawrence did, this is not a siloed nutrition issue. This is cross-sectoral, which is why today's panel and today's discussion brings together not only experts in nutrition, but in health systems, in social protection. This has to be a multi-sectoral effort. And as Lawrence said, the goal today is to help us formulate specific recommendations for USAID so they can continue their leadership to save children's lives and ensure they have the opportunity for children around the world to reach their true potential. So we really are looking to push the boundaries here and come up with some fresh ways of thinking and approaching the problem. So I'm delighted to begin to set the stage for this discussion with our first speaker, Dr. Catherine Dewey, who's probably known to many of you. Kay is a distinguished professor emerita of nutrition at the University of California, Davis. She's co-founder of UC Davis's Institute for Global Nutrition, and her research has focused on maternal and child nutrition in vulnerable populations. Perfect person to start us off. Kay?
Thank you very much, Kathy. It's really an honor to be here and to discuss with all of you this really critical topic. So I would like to present some of the key highlights from the Fed to Fail report that was published by UNICEF in 2021. And I'd like to thank Victor Aguayo and Grania Maloney for sharing some of their slides with me. They're quite attractive. But I'll have some others as well for you. So first, let's briefly review why diets matter so much in early childhood. So children under 2 years have extraordinary nutrient needs, and this is because a child's brain grows to 75% of adult size, and more than 1 million new neuron connections are formed every second. Height increases by 75%, and body weight quadruples. So as a result, children under 2 have very high nutrient needs, but they consume only a small amount of food. So their diets need to be very high in nutrient density, which by that I mean the number of nutrients per 100 calories. This figure here shows the minimum target iron and zinc densities of solid foods, which we call complementary foods because they are meant to complement breast milk during this age. And these estimates are based on average breast milk intake at 3 age intervals. You can see that the needs are highest at 6 to 8 months in blue here, and especially for iron. In fact, infants need 9 times as much iron per 100 calories as an adult male. But it's often the adult male in the household who gets the most preferred food, not the infant. So as a result, we see many nutrient gaps in complementary food diets in low-income populations. The usual problem nutrients are iron and zinc, but other nutrients may also be low, including things like calcium, potassium, choline, and omega-3 fatty acids. And we've learned that it's actually very difficult to construct a diet that's adequate in all nutrients from purely unfortified foods during infancy. Now, the consequences of poor diets and feeding practices in early life are visible in the age distribution of stunting and wasting. And as the figure on the left here shows, the prevalence of stunting increases between 6 months and 2 years of age and then levels off. And when we look at wasting on the right, more than half of all children under 5 with wasting are younger than 2 years of age. So I encourage you to read the Fed to Fail report, which provides a comprehensive update on young children's diets. I'll only have a few aspects of that to comment on today due to time constraints. But I wanted to show you some of the results from the analysis that was conducted in 2020. And that showed that among children 6 to 23 months, most were not fed according to global recommendations, as Kathy pointed out. About half of children are not fed the minimum recommended number of meals. About half are missing the benefits of the most nutrient-rich foods, like fruits and vegetables and eggs, fish or meat. And only 29% globally are fed even a minimally diverse diet that they need to grow in development. And unfortunately, children's diets have not mostly improved in the last decade. Among the 50 countries with trend data, less than half, only 21 countries, have noted a significant increase in the percentage of children fed a minimally diverse diet between 2010 and 2020, shown on the right. However, even more worrisome is the fact that 10 countries on the left have experienced a drop during that time period in this particular indicator. So there are many barriers to good diets for young children. The evidence from regional analyses and focus group discussions showed that families struggle to find and afford nutritious foods for their children, as depicted by the orange circles here for affordability, availability, and access. And some of the reasons for this are listed on the right. The high cost of nutritious foods is one of the greatest obstacles, cited by almost 80% of respondents. Availability of nutritious foods can also be an issue, especially in rural and remote areas. And physical access may be a barrier, for example, in poor urban communities. So climate change, conflicts, and the pandemic are all exacerbating this situation. Even if nutritious foods are available and affordable, children's diets are constrained by social, cultural, and gender barriers. One of those is time pressures, which influence infant child feeding decisions, and this was cited by 62% of respondents. And to cope with this time crunch, some caregivers turn to the convenience of processed and fast foods. And in some settings, mothers lack the autonomy to decide what to feed their children, which can be a barrier to achieving dietary adequacy. So this issue of unhealthy processed foods and drinks is a major one. They are widely accessible and heavily marketed, even in the poorest of communities. And this figure shows that about one in three children at this age in several countries were fed at least one unhealthy food or drink daily. Sugary foods and drinks are of particular concern because they are high in calories but low in vital nutrients. So young children may fill up on them and consequently have very little appetite for nutrient-dense foods. But despite these barriers, there are opportunities for meeting the nutritional needs of young children. And the good news is that the potential impact of providing a nutritious diet is enormous. Now, there are several strategies to meet nutrient needs during this age. And of course, the first priority is to promote diverse diets and selection of nutrient-rich complementary foods. But as has been pointed out, affordability of such foods is a major constraint. So for that reason, several fortified products have been developed and tested, including fortified blended foods and products used for home fortification, in which the nutrients are mixed directly with the food provided to the baby in the home. And that can be achieved with products such as micronutrient powders or, for example, small quantity lipid-based nutrient supplements, which I've done a fair bit of work on. The usual daily dose of SQLNS is only about 4 teaspoons. And this includes 22 vitamins and minerals, essential fatty acids, and some high-quality protein. Now, adequately addressing nutrient needs at this age can have profound beneficial effects. And as an example, I'll show you some results for SQLNS, which has been shown to improve child survival, prevent child malnutrition, and promote healthy development. In a meta-analysis in 2019, SQLNS reduced all-cause mortality by 27% at this age. In a set of papers published last year, we demonstrated that SQLNS reduced stunting by 12%, wasting by 14%, iron deficiency anemia by 64%, and delayed development by 16 to 19%. And just last year, we extended those analyses and demonstrated that SQLNS reduced severe wasting by 31%, and severe stunting by 17%. And this impact has not gone unnoticed. Interventions to improve the diets of young children, in bold on this slide, are prominent in the Lancet series on maternal and child undernutrition. And as you can see on the right here, in 2021, preventive SQLNS for optimizing health and growth in young children was added to the previous list published in 2013. Now, the Fed-to-Fail report calls for bolder actions and greater accountability to address this crisis of children's diets. And these actions are grouped into four categories: actions to transform the food system, actions to mobilize the full potential of the health system, actions through the social protection system, and actions under multi-system governance. And I hope that we'll have some time later in the discussion today to discuss all of these in more detail. And with that, I'd like to thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks very much, Kay. Our next speaker is probably well known to World Food Prize veterans, Dr. Will Masters, who is now a professor at the Friedman School of Nutrition at Tufts, though he has a secondary appointment in Tufts Department of Economics. He is the director of the Food Prices for Nutrition Project, which focuses on ways of measuring access to a healthy diet around the world. So perfect next speaker.
Thank you, and it is a great privilege to follow Cassie and Kay, and to share some of the results of our work at Tufts. As Kathy mentioned, I'm an economist. We've been looking at food prices, thinking about the food environment and how conditions around the household influence the cost, the affordability of the infant foods that are so desperately needed, as Kay mentioned. So in the slides, I'll share some results from this Food Prices for Nutrition project in particular, but also a variety of other work funded by USAID and other donors with partners all around the world, mainly from Africa. So I'm going to start with a bit more granular data on what from what Kay shared, looking month by month to see this age pattern in different types of malnutrition from month to month as children enter and go through the 6 to 24 month window that the Fed to Thrive report from BIFAD will be about. So this extraordinary panel, I'll have a chance to sort of dig into some of the remedies for this. But what you see is the anemia resulting from micronutrient deficiencies that Kay mentioned, as well as disease conditions, that peaking at this extraordinary high prevalence rate, above 70%, as Kay mentioned, only in that early part of the 6 to 24 month window. Then, second line, stunting, rising primarily after 6 months of age, as attained height is down-regulated in response to the many deficiencies of the child's growth potential, ability to reach their growth potential, and then wasting, being so high in the early years and declining as the calorie balance to meet the lower stature is a bit easier to attain, often from these empty calories of starchy staples and so forth. And thinking about the difficulty of meeting infant needs in the 6 to 24 month window really comes down to the challenge of introducing foods one by one as the child approaches their household's family foods. And what you see in this chart is a paper that I did with a colleague at IFPRI, Derek Heady, taking the demographic and health data survey results and showing how in the count of food groups fed to infants in the 6 to 24 month window, to reach the minimum level of diet diversity for children, which would be about 4 out of the 7 different distinct food groups in addition to continued breastfeeding, initially children receive very few, you know, often none additional foods, and then at 6 months rising. And the point is that only in the richest third of households does that threshold of 4 get met on average. And even that is only at 18 months, most of the way through the window. So this is about convergence to the family diet and the role of the family diet in determining whether it's even possible to meet infant needs. And the key insight, moving more in more granular form towards the dig into the results that Kay shared, that it's really only these richest households that have the means to acquire the individual food groups that would be delivering the nutrients that infants need. On the far left, you see that the only nutrient-rich food group that low-income households are able to afford is this dark green leafy vegetable food group that's very labor-intensive to prepare, perishable, and so forth. All the other nutrient-rich food groups, both the vitamin A-rich vegetables and all of the animal source foods especially, are so expensive and so costly that only richer households are able to afford them. And even then, dairy, the only one that's consumed by a majority of children is the dairy in the middle of the chart. And one important exception to think about is dried fish, which is equally consumed across income groups. So our kind of specialty is thinking about food prices and the food environment in the ability of agricultural production, distribution, markets to make it possible for households to meet needs. And here we've been modeling older children. This chart starts with 4 to 6 year olds and moves on through each age group. You see women in red, the cost per day rising to levels above what low-income households have available to spend on food in adolescence before pregnancy. And this is really crucial to understand pre-pregnancy nutrition regarding that early micronutrient deficiency and in utero growth retardation and deprivation that is so common. But the important thing really is diet quality. And on the right, you see cost per calorie or per 100 calories. And what you see is it's the red line for women during late adolescence and then especially during breastfeeding that is so much more expensive, requiring the more costly foods to meet the needs of the mother in order to provide adequate nutrition to the child. And we are working alongside the World Food Program and their cost of diet work and our food prices for nutrition work, working in parallel in response to this agenda that the BIFAD Fed to Thrive report is about, to try to dig more deeply into how the food environment makes it easy or hard for infants. Big opportunity to model that carefully and understand. And on the left, what you see is this point that Kay made, that the quantity and therefore the cost per day is actually quite low because the total volume is very small, perhaps 50, 60, 70 grams a day of this food. But it's so exquisitely sensitive to the exact quality of that food. And so if we turn to the kinds of nutrient-dense products that me, as an economist, I study what households buy and sell, what households buy and that food companies are selling. And we're going to hear from Sini, her experience in Senegal, providing a kind of a set of products of this type. By far the most common type that's sold around the world are the premixed cereals that Kay mentioned. So Kay has been an extraordinary pioneer and leader in the development of this SQLNS approach to very small quantity lipid-based nutritional supplements. When you ask what is sold actually around the world, by far the dominant infant food is premixed cereals. That's some kind of cereal, rice, wheat, so forth, fortified typically with soybeans or some other source of protein and additional fat, plus often a micronutrient powder. And that basic recipe comes primarily in the United States, North America, from the history of pablum. You see on the top left, that's where the word comes from. Developed at the Toronto Hospital for Sick Kids. In the middle, you have Incaparina, introduced in Central America in 1961. On the far right, the global blockbuster product is Nestle's Cerelac, introduced after World War II. Massive advertising all around the world, dominant market share, over 90% in most of Latin America, over 80% market share in much of Africa. On the bottom right, you see all of the many, many locally produced products around Africa. That's just two examples, one from Rwanda, one from Malawi. And then the blockbuster Food Aid product, which is Super Cereal Plus. And what I want to share is just some testing of these results. Of these products, which we did buying products and testing them. Most of them, almost two-thirds, inadequate in both iron and zinc that Kay highlighted. On the top right of that, you see plenty of products, like no doubt Sini's, that are adequate. But the key insight is this variation was completely random, impossible to explain, not correlated with labeling information and so forth, without a third-party certification, without a standard that's set by some international agency and then enforced, it is impossible for these companies to maintain and signal quality. And so what we have in conclusion is this need to create these products and the difficulty of setting standards and establishing them. So if there's one recommendation to BIFAD from this work, it would be this role of standard setting and enforcement. that family diets are absolutely crucial and difficult to attain and require a whole suite of multi-sectoral interventions, as we've talked about, and includes addressing the issue of competitive foods that substitute, and the crucial role of maternal and adolescent women's diets. It's so difficult to meet. So I think we have just a really great opportunity with this panel, and it's been a privilege to introduce some of these data, which I hope can be helpful to BIFAD. Thank you.
You'll see we don't have gender diversity on this panel. Shout out for women. With that great context setting from both Will and Kay, we now want to look at entry points and incentives to get to a place where children can have access to safe, affordable, and nutritious foods. So the panel is going to discuss ways to bring down the cost of the healthy food basket, improve the nutrient content, improve the convenience, help women access safety nets, and how to engage across systems, because as I said before, we really need a multi-sectoral effort. I'm going to briefly introduce each panelist and then have some questions specific to each of them, but I invite you to join in, other panelists. Sini Samba is here from Senegal. Thank you for traveling so far. She is co-founder and CEO of Le Lionceau in Dakar, Senegal. It is a company that specializes in the production of natural and high-quality food for babies. Fallon Tep Casper is head of debt agriculture and food at IncoFin Investment Management, and she oversees their global debt investments in the agro and the food sector. Manisha Tarney is a public health professional with 20 years of experience in nutrition, working in both Africa and in Asia. Has also worked in health system strengthening and gender. Most recently, she was with West Africa Program Director at the Alive and Thrive Project. And last but not least, Deanna Olney from IFPRI, the International Food Policy Research Institute. She is a senior research fellow there. She is also the lead of a new initiative on fruit and vegetables for sustainable healthy diets, the acronym of which is FRESH. So we are going to start with you, Sini. I think you run an amazing company. You're using locally sourced foods. You partner with local farmers. You've engaged women's groups to grow the produce. So I want to ask, what got you started on this venture? Why did you start to make these baby foods? And as you look at it, and as we've heard, very expensive to make nutrient-dense foods, how do you tackle that? Do you see that there are ways to bring the cost down of nutritious foods for kids? So please, start with your story.
Thank you so much for the invitation. It's an honor to be here. So I'm coming from Senegal. And like Cathy said, I have a company which is specialized in producing baby food, infant flour, purees, and biscuits from local raw material. So it all started when I was a little girl. I used to help my grandmother to make biscuits and male meals with our local crops that we weekly distribute to children who live in the street. So I grew in this social environment, and after my studies in France, I work for the French leading company in baby food as a food processing engineer in nutrition. Then I discovered this field of early childhood and I became passionate about nutrition. So I start asking questions, what about my native country, Senegal? What can we find in the market? What moms does to give to babies? So I realized that in the market, we found mainly imported products. And when I see on the other side, we see that smallholder farmers have a lot of farm losses. For example, in the mango field, we have 60% of mangoes which are lost in the field. And of course, always malnutrition. So I asked to myself, why not valorizing our resources and put in the market products that fit to our eating local habits and that will strengthen the local food value chain by collaborating with smallholder farmers. That's how L'Alliance was born, and now we have five years of activity.
And what about the cost? Are your baby foods more expensive in the market than other foods that are less nutritious?
Well, our cost, we are between 20 and 15% cheaper than the product that we have found in the market. But it's not easy to have affordable product. No, it's not easy. Because, you know, we are working in all the value chain. For example, when there is one problem in a part of the value chain, it will impact in all the other costs on the final product. For example, for the smallholder farmers, usually they have fruits, vegetables that are perishable. So after they can add the cost in the final raw material that will sell to us. And also they have logistics problem. For example, we have to go to their field to make the transportation of the raw material, and it costs a lot to our company, because smallholder farmers, they mostly didn't have van or car to transport the raw material, so it costs a lot. And the last point is that if we want to have nutrient-dense food, we have to pay attention in the formulation. Because, for example, in our puris, we tell that we need at least 80% of percentage of fruits, so we can have products that have high nutritional value. But we could maybe just put 5% of fruits, added water, sugar, and then our cost will decrease. So at the end, if you want to have a high quality baby food, it really, really costs.
So I may put you on the spot with a personal question. Your company is 5 years old. Assuming you're now making a profit, a small one, are you? And when did that, how many years in did that happen?
I start having profit 2 months before.
2 months ago?
2 months ago, yeah.
Well, this is going to turn me to our next panelist then, Fallon, because you are in the financing space. So we now know because of perishability of fruits, a lot of food loss, nutrient-dense foods are really expensive to produce. So what does financing in this space look like for companies like L'Alliance? How do you sell those as valuable investments to your investors, or do you?
Well, thank you very much for the invitation to be here, and it's been very interesting to hear all of the perspectives on nutrition from a very learned group of panelists. In the impact investing space where Incofin works, the company that I represent, we are developing a nutritious fund called the Nutritious Financing Food Facility together with GAIN. And it's meant to be a whole systems approach, because really one of the things that we've learned in this journey to really increase the availability, the affordability, the accessibility of foods is that it really needs to be from a multiple sectorial approach, so approaching the entire value chain. Things like cold chain, for example, is something that is very important in ensuring that the food is doesn't become contaminated on its way to the different distribution centers, but cold chain facilities are very difficult to come by in sub-Saharan Africa. So that's just one example of the whole systems approach. We look at how can we, as impact investors, really support the enabling environment. And that can come from a variety of different approaches. As impact investors, we have a creative fund structure that we've developed that incorporates different types of share classes within a fund, so that there is a catalytic tranche where different investors, let's say, that invest in our fund will be able to take a more long-term position. So for example, what we call a catalytic investment tranche is something that can provide more patient capital, or they might be willing to take the first loss. And why do we need these types of structures? Because investing in nutritious companies in sub-Saharan Africa means that we're working with local companies, smaller companies, companies that may not have a very very, very technified approach. So really being able to invest in these companies can be much riskier for investors. And that risk can sometimes be compensated by things like first loss guarantees or by other types of de-risking mechanisms, blended finance approaches that can really help unlock a lot of this potential investments. This fund called N3F is really a pioneer in specifically focusing on nutrition, but it hasn't been a very easy fundraising journey because it's not, from the investment perspective, not a very traditional approach. Nutrition is a blend of many different perspectives. So you're not just looking at agriculture, you're actually looking at a much broader view. And in that way, you really provide an ecosystems approach.
I think Sini is listening with interest, as is your partner, Lawrence Haddad. And I imagine when we get to public Q&A, Lawrence, you may have some comments and a question you want to ask. As we look at this and talk about what Kay alluded to in her remarks, that mothers over the world, while they have primary responsibility for caregiving for their children, have social pressures, have time pressures, have financial pressures, don't have the autonomy necessarily to make sure their children are fed well with the products that your investments are supporting and that your company is making. So Manisha, I want to turn to you because we know that even when mothers know what nutritious food is, that when they're pressed for time and money, they are drawn to unhealthy snack foods, high convenience foods that are right there in front of them that their kids want to eat, that are often marketed with very misleading claims about their nutrition content. So what are these moms and their families' perceptions of nutritious foods? How can we make those foods more appealing to moms so that we incentivize them to make pro-nutrition choices for their family with the support of their mothers and their mothers-in-law and their husbands?
So it's an honor to be here today and wonderful to be amongst you all. I think as Kay rightly pointed out, children's diets are influenced by social, gender, and cultural barriers, and women should not have to face these barriers alone. I'm going to share some experiences of solutions that have been tested from designing programs as well as implementing it from the project that I worked on, or the initiative Alive and Thrive. And here we used a system strengthening approach to really try and improve, change behaviors and to try and improve the consumption of more desirable foods amongst women, children, and families. I want to share some of the solutions that we think worked. Some of them are mentioned in the Fed to Fail report. The first thing that worked based on our experience was that intensity matters. So while when implementing programs around improving young children's diets, it's really important to share messages, to share counseling through multiple platforms and channels of communication, including digital media, and to really focus on what is appropriate for young children, and make the foods much more desirable. So that's one. The second solution that worked is to focus not just on mothers. So we find that a number of programs really focus only on mothers, but from our experience, it's absolutely critical. If we want to change social norms at the societal level, it's absolutely critical to focus on not just on mothers, but other family members, you know, and other caregivers, especially because we know in many countries, mothers live in intergenerational households. So it's absolutely important to focus on grandmothers and fathers who control the purse strings in many households, as we know. But more importantly, it's also important to engage community leaders and service providers, staff from different multiple sectors, so not just health, but food, education, employers, and most importantly, policymakers and legislators. So it's really, if we want to change young children's diets, it's really critical to focus on all these various audiences, and really that's what's going to change the social norms. The third lesson that we've learned is that many programs try to do too much, and nutrition programs are really successful when they focus on few behaviors. And of course, the question that arises in all our minds is which behaviors and how do we focus on that? And our experience has shown that it's really critical to look at the data at the country level, at the global level, and look at which behaviors have the greatest impact. I think this morning we heard that diversity of diets as well as quantity of foods that children eat is really critical. So by focusing on a few key behaviors, we can really better implement and reach programs. Our fourth lesson is not just to focus on behaviors, but really understand what drives those behaviors. I think we know that mothers report over and over again that, you know, time constraints is the big barrier that they face. And we've tried to address that by really understanding what are the social norms and how do we support mothers with that. One of the ways that we tried, influencing this behavior in South Asia, in Bangladesh, in India, where animal source foods are available and affordable to some extent, was really by sharing with mothers, or by saying that, you know, when children are fed animal source foods, they cry less, they're more busy, and that way you have more time to focus on your chores. So the message that we tested was like, I as a mother, if I feed my child milk and eggs, then my child cries less, plays more, and I have more time for household chores. So you can come up with very simple, doable actions to address some of these constraints. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And so, Sini, I'm thinking about you not only as CEO of your own company, but as a mom of a young infant. Does what Manisha say resonate with you? Did anything particularly jump out at you as, yes, that's right, that's my family she's talking about?
Yes, completely. I experienced it with my mother. So mother-in-law really have an impact on the nutrition of the children. So, you know, when I let my son, for example, to my mother's house, usually she can say, oh, he can eat sugar, pastries, it will not hurt him. But you know, as a nutritionist, it was very difficult, and sometimes it created a little conflict. And I realized that for this challenge of infant nutrition, it's not just about having good food, but it is very important to raise awareness about the importance of infant nutrition, the importance of the first 1,000 days, so then we will have change. Otherwise, we will always continue to distribute food, but we all want change.
Any comments on that, Manisha?
It's great to hear that. And when I read the Fed to Fail report, I was kind of really happy to read the statistic that the health system in particular is counseling mothers, and read almost 80% of caregivers and mothers have been reached through the health system. But I think we need to do a lot more to raise awareness. And like I mentioned, that using intensity and reaching out using multiple platforms and channels is really critical.
And of course, health systems have been incredibly challenged by COVID.
That's right.
Over the last few years. But if we talk about the price points for nutritious foods, getting moms to want to feed their children food, there's still going to be nutritious foods that moms want that, even if they're 15% less expensive than other foods, are beyond the reach. So that's where we come to safety nets, to social protection, particularly with health systems having been strained by COVID, and I assume safety nets having been strained by COVID. So I'm going to turn to Deanna and ask, what role can they play? What are the challenges right now? What are the successes in social safety nets, whether it's actual food, whether it's cash transfers, conditional or not conditional, food vouchers? What role can they play in getting these foods to kids that need them.
Thanks, and I'll also say thanks for inviting me and having me on this panel. It's been very interesting hearing all the different perspectives. So yes, I've been working quite a bit on reviewing the evidence on social protection programs and how they can be used to improve nutrition over the last several years. And some of the things that come out very strongly is that it's not obvious that, you know, just providing a transfer is going to lead to any type of change in diets or nutrition outcomes. They weren't designed for that. Traditionally, they were designed to address, you know, food security issues, immediate, you know, needs for household cash. And so there is a need to rethink how social safety nets are designed to make them work for nutrition. We find that for women specifically, I mean, there aren't a lot of studies that have looked at impacts on men or other family members. Mostly, if you're talking about diet or nutrition outcomes, it's been the focus on women and children, and so that's what I can speak to. But for women, you know, providing cash or vouchers or food does lead to improvements in dietary diversity, for example, but that doesn't ring true for infants and for young children, where less than half of the studies that have looked at this have found impacts on diet diversity. And I think this gets to, you know, the points that have been raised by some of the other panelists that, you know, the children aren't necessarily the priority for, you know, more diverse foods or higher quality foods. And, you know, there's a bit of a gap potentially in the prioritization of what you do with extra cash, or even just that the kids don't necessarily want the you know, more vegetables or more meat or whatnot. And so I think there's a need to kind of think about how these programs are being designed. And this could include things like including strong BCC that's, you know, addressing the multiple family members to think about if you're getting, you know, a transfer of any sort, you know, how can you use that to improve the diets of young children. You can also think about targeting to households with children, women and children in the first 1,000 days, or if you're doing a more blanket targeting of a social safety net, providing an additional component, like a fortified supplement, like Kay mentioned, like the LNS or a fortified blended food, corn soy blend, to the women and children in the first 1,000 days to directly support their nutrient needs, or an extra, you know, portion of a cash transfer that's designated for women and children in the first 1,000 days. These types of actions can, you know, have a direct effect. We have evaluated a few USAID programs that were designed, you know, to improve the nutrition of women and children in the first 1,000 days, and we found in those programs the programs that were the most effective were the ones that were the most intense, the ones that provided food and behavior change communication and linkages with health services for the full 1,000 days, that had both the household and family transfer, so that our household and an individual transfer, so that there was food being provided for the household general consumption, but also a targeted fortified product for the women and children in the first 1,000 days. The bad news is that those programs are the most expensive, right? But if we really want to improve diets and nutrition, you know, the investment is probably worth it, because if you have a less intense or less robust program, you may not have any impact on diets or nutrition. You know, you still may have, you know, impacts on food security or other outcomes that may be equally important, but if the goal is to improve diets or nutrition, we really need to think about the package of interventions, the size of the interventions, and the targeting of those interventions. The other thing I would like to mention is that the evidence in this space is actually pretty thin, you know, and so I think although we have seen, you know, some associations and there have been some studies that have been specifically designed to look at variations in size of transfers or inclusion of complementary program interventions, there's not much to draw on, especially when thinking about overall diet quality, not just diet diversity, thinking about micronutrient deficiencies. And so I think more investment in those areas and actually testing some of these ideas that we think that targeting these transfers to women will make a difference. We think that including, you know, both household and individual transfers make a difference. But this is based on very few studies, right? And very few studies that have actually been designed to rigorously test these assumptions. And so I think if we're thinking about costs and how to reach more people, if we find more the most cost-effective ways of programming, you know, then we have an opportunity to expand, you know, coverage of these types of programs. And then lastly, you know, when we did these studies of the USAID programs, we did find that when looking at cost effectiveness, that increasing the duration of the programs actually could lead to cost savings. Traditionally, the types of programs that USAID funds, whether it's the Title II programs or emergency aid, are fairly short in duration. And so even once you have an effective program, it ends after a few years, and then a new cycle comes in, and you have to restart everything, redesign, you know, the interventions, redesign the targeting, et cetera, and that leads to waste, you know, in terms of costs. And so there is some evidence that if you have an effective program, increasing the duration of that program could also save costs, which again could lead to increased coverage. So I think I'll stop there. Thanks.
That's a lot of information. Thanks. One last question before we open up first to BIFAD members for questions and then to the audience. Fallon, listening to all of this, any ahas for you or anything that might get your wheels turning about the financing space and the project with GAIN?
You know, I've been thinking a lot about the enabling environments, because a lot of these different projects and the interventions that happen really can help support the eventual increase in SMEs that can really address nutrition by producing healthy foods. So things, for example, like adequately trained technical experts that can really support, you know, the food safety preparation in these companies is something that I've heard maybe can be lacking. Local value chain strengthening, the supply chains, the production in the fields, these are all areas that are projects that are being implemented already that can strengthen the entire ecosystem. So distribution, value chains, technical experts, really scaling up production efficiencies in all of the different areas as enabling actors.
Okay, thanks. So Kay and Will, I think the best thing might be for you to come up and share the podium, because you are not exempt from the questions. And there are specific questions that my fellow BIFAD members want to ask to help us crystallize our recommendations to USAID. But while they're asking their questions, I ask those of you online and in the room to think about your questions for the speakers and the panelists that are going to help us arrive at concrete, actionable, doable recommendations for USAID. So in that spirit, Kay, I'm going to start with you. Your overview was terrific. I know the Fed to Fail report had many, many recommendations, and we gave you a time limit so you couldn't get into those recommendations. When we think specifically about USAID, what is USAID's comparative advantage in this space? And if you had to prioritize, I'm only giving you four. What are the four recommendations USAID should take on from the Fed to Fail report?
And if I could have the last four slides, because I kind of knew this was coming, and I wanted to show you the, there were 10 recommendations from the Fed to Fail report. And they're in those four categories that I mentioned to you. And so I think it is perhaps useful to show them to you. So the first set were actions to transform the food system. And you can see there are three of them up here. And if I had to choose, I'm going to choose one from each of the four categories that I personally think that USAID has a very strong sort of competitive advantage and very deep experience with. And the first one there is, number one, increasing the availability and affordability of nutritious foods, including, very important here, what's listed, fruits, vegetables, eggs, fish, meat, and fortified foods, by incentivizing their production, distribution, and retailing. And this is important because these are the nutrient-dense foods that we talked about before, but they're not necessarily the ones that have had the most investment, which tend to be those cereal-based foods that historically have been part of food aid programs. So we need far more attention on these other types of products, and that's where the expertise on both production and food safety aspects of these are very important, because many of these are perishable. Not to say that two and three are not important, it's just that for USAID, I think number one might be a really critical place to take a leading role. They can, of course, be very supportive of the other things, such as number two, the implementation of standards for many of these initiatives. And then for the, let's see, where do I point this? Can I have the next one? In the second set, it's the actions to mobilize the full potential of the health system. And here, the number four is more directed at programs on the ground in country. So that perhaps would be a much broader mandate. Number five, though, I think is something that, again, USAID could really take a leading role in terms of delivering dietary supplements, home fortificants, and fortified complementary foods. And there are many, many ways that that could be done and integrated into multi-sectoral types of actions. Then in the next category, actions through the social protection system, you know, both of these are very, very important. I would probably pick the number six, designing these and supporting them that they don't undermine nutritious and safe foods in early childhood. So making sure that that is a part of the larger strategy that USAID is implementing. And then lastly, the actions under the multi-sectoral governance. I would probably pick number 10. I'm a researcher myself, so of course anything that has to do with research is important. But honestly, I think that we've learned from Alive and Thrive and from other efforts, lots of IFPRI evaluations, that a rigorous evaluation of what's going on can really help guide what to prioritize, how to modify programs that are on the ground, and also understanding better the enablers and the barriers to the kinds of outcomes that you're looking for. So those would be the four that I would highlight.
Thank you very much. And now I think we're going to take some questions from BIFAD members who are participating virtually.
Yes? Okay. Cynia or others, commercial production of complementary foods is not often regulated, and there are few countries that have standards in place as to the composition of these foods, let alone enforcement of these standards. How can USAID programs support the necessary policy work to get standards in place that are going to be really important?
Thank you for the question. The question of standardization is a very big problem because, for example, last week when I was in the street of in Dakar, I saw a van and there was a poster, a poster in the van where we see a baby with big cheeks. So this company was telling that this product is good for the babies. Otherwise, the products were not specific for babies. It was just juice, but they were showing that this product are adapted to babies. So these kind of things created an unfair competition. So we are facing with products that are very cheaper, and for us, we're producing products for babies under two, it is very difficult to have to compete with these companies. So the affordability is very complicated, and I think that most of the programs, usually they didn't target the early stage. From my experience, when I had this idea of creating the baby food, I would like to target the most vulnerable populations with the product. But when I came back in Senegal, I realized that being small, it was very difficult to target this most vulnerable population. So I have to change my business plan and to start it from the middle of the pyramid, and years, once the business is growing, to widen the target to the bottom of the pyramid. But if there was some investment finance at the early stage, and it will help us to make food that feeds to the standards, and we will have economy of scale economies, which will help us to reduce the cost and to have more affordable products.
So I see Fallon nodding, and this certainly points to Kay's point about standards. Pamela Anderson, I thought we had a question from you.
Thank you, great. Kathy, and good morning, everyone. And thank you to all of the speakers and panelists. One of the things that has come through very clearly in the publications that you have sent us, and you have certainly underscored it in your presentations this morning, is that one of the changes that we need to make is this pivot to a multi-sectoral approach, moving away from our compartments and our silos to really harness a multi-sectorial approach to this problem. So the question that I have, and this is really for any of you and also the people in the virtual and physical audience, is what specific institutional advice do you have for USAID? What do we need to change? What do we need to do to make this pivot towards a multi-sectoral approach? Is it about structure? Is it about programming? Is it about financing? What else? What can you help us with in terms of recommendations to start moving in that direction? Thanks.
Important, broad question. Anybody want to dive in? Will is cogitating. Manisha has lots of USAID experience. Anybody want to jump in?
One key thing, which I think is coming out of Deanna's evidence on cost effectiveness, and that concerns a challenge of doing things 5 years at a time. So for very natural reasons, there is a central focus on the projectization of work for USAID. But that has very serious limitations. And I think USAID does have a big opportunity now to think about the broader enabling environment over a longer term, and to think about that institutional framework we're talking about in terms of quality standards, institutions, and enforcement of those, as well as the many other multi-sectoral initiatives. So thinking beyond the five-year window is just one particular insight.
I'm going to be very mindful of time, as we've got a few minutes left before we go public. Lawrence, I believe you had a question. So Lawrence is here in the flesh.
Yes, I did. And this question relates to any specific policy programmatic changes that you would suggest. We know that social protection programs only work if they reach the people who need them. What specific policy changes or program changes could USAID make to ensure the safety nets reach the families who need them? And this is a question I'd like to direct first to Deanna.
Thanks. So, I mean, I think that, you know, the example I gave, I mean, USAID has done programming that targets specifically women and children in the first 1,000 days. The Food for Peace program back in 2010 had an iteration of specifically targeting women and children in the first 1,000 days, and I think that that could be revisited. And I think that there are the other opportunities that I mentioned, that even with, you know, a more general kind of social assistance program, whether it's, you know, emergency aid or resilience building activities, even if it's, you know, targeted more generally to the poor or poor areas, there could be an addition of when you identify, you know, when you register beneficiaries or, you know, make your list, if there's families that have children under 2 years of age or pregnant women, you could add an additional component for those families, whether it be a, you know, LNS or a corn soy blend or something else that will bolster, you know, the diets of the women and children in that vulnerable period. Thanks.
Thanks. As we transition to public Q&A period, which is going to be moderated by Sawita Liverpool-Tassier from BIFAD, she first has her own question for the panel. But Sawita, why don't you come take this middle chair and mic, because you can moderate your questions from up here.
Okay. I think just because it's early morning, I'm actually going to do my moderation standing up. So that I can stay, not that it's boring, but I just need to move around a little bit. One of the questions that we had thought about, you know, discussing in BIFAD, that is sort of the basis, or one of the basis for this today's discussion, is this issue of higher costs, right? So Sini kind of explained to us some areas or entry points where there's like high transportation costs, and then the implication that filters down into the cost of these nutritious foods. And so one question that we had was, you know, what targeted policies and programs do you think USAID could support specifically in this area of reducing the cost of these diets? So this is open to any of you.
Maybe I can take a stab at this. Reducing the cost of food is not an immediate solution. It doesn't take a short time. Why? You have to invest in technification, in machinery, in economies of scale, in really building and thinking through your supply chain to extend over a specific period of time things that can reduce the cost of food and therefore the cost of production of food. So really, really thinking about how do you go and thinking about Sini's company as you seek to reduce the cost while being mindful that nutrition is costly, right? You don't want to dilute your production. It's also about investment. It's about, you know, what machines do I need, or what very specialized personnel do I bring on that can really think about efficiencies in my value chain? And that is something that can really help support over time more efficient production, more effective production, that over time can really generate an ecosystem improvement that can reduce costs.
Yeah, okay.
Just add one element on this, and that's what is the cost of a nutritious diet for a household? There's been some wonderful work done. Will's done some of it. The World Food Program has quite a lot of work on the cost of a nutritious diet for a household of five in low and middle income countries. And they have looked specifically at the cost of achieving a nutritious diet for children under two, for pregnant women. And one thing that is very apparent is that if you just cost out meeting your nutrient needs from unfortified foods, it's very, very high for those two target groups. If you add in some sort of fortified product for pregnant women, it could be a multiple micronutrient tablet for the young children, some sort of fortified product, it reduces the cost sometimes by half and increases dramatically the percentage of households that now can afford a nutritious diet. So combining these types of strategies is one way to get there.
Thank you so much. And maybe does anyone on the panel want to maybe talk about some of the other potential areas post-production? So a lot of great points about on the production, and also this idea of introducing these fortification at low cost. Are there any thoughts about what USAID could support, maybe the ecosystem that would allow some of those costs that Simi mentioned that are along the supply chain, but then translate into higher costs? And I'm looking at Will.
Advantages of this ecosystem approach of seeing the enabling environment is to think about the power of the market and to think about the power of competition, of diversity of suppliers. A country like Senegal, one could imagine instead of just a couple of very large multinationals and then small local companies, you could imagine four or five national players, and that requires this environment of quality standards that prevent the kind of undercutting of the phenomenon that you described of the van in Dakar with the billboard advertising something that is manifestly false and yet persuasive. And so how can that be addressed so that there is competition, not just one company at a time, but a whole market?
Thank you. So as we move to the public Q&A, because we have people in the room and people online, I'm going to actually start with a couple of questions, or one question online, and then I'll transition to all those of us here in the room. But I do want to ask that please, all of our participants online, if you have questions or comments, please post them, as Lawrence mentioned. And for those in the room, hopefully we get to all the questions, but even if you don't have the chance to ask it now, please make sure that you communicate it to us, and you can do that through through Clara. Okay, so the one question online is sort of building on this conversation, and it's a question on the last point made by Will and reiterated by Henri and Cindy just now, and it still relates to this idea of regulations and regulating the weaning and complementary food formulas. So thinking about whether these should be established via Codex Alimentarius, which is a regulatory body and part of FAO, WHO, the Food Standards Program of FAO, WHO, and what role USAID can play in supporting this. So this is a question for Will, but I think open to others on the panel as well. Did you get that, Will?
Sure, yes, thank you. Just talking with Sean Baker earlier, clearly a lot of this infrastructure is already in place. And the question is it possible for the agency, and I hope that this Fed to Thrive report will make that possible, to think beyond the project at a time and one company at a time into this enabling environment and to think about which particular institutions. Now, I would never want to prejudge that process because it's political in nature, it's institutional in nature. And the question is to get the ball rolling around the expert panels, the commissions that would proceed in partnership with industry and with public health nutrition authorities, WHO globally, regional authorities to establish those standards. So it's about a process more than pre-specifying what that outcome would be.
Thank you so much. Does anybody else on the panel want to attempt that question?
Yeah, just to add, like we said, it is very important to have a cross multi-sectoral collaboration, and we have to build the standards, for example, with the private sector organization and also the state. So then we can have, if the private sector can have food which fit to the standards, maybe we can go higher on the state and having reducing taxes, for example, for food for babies under two. So it will help also to reduce the cost and, by the way, fitting those standards.
Okay. So I think I hear some call for maybe USAID using their power to negotiate or engage with governments to sort of support the creating of this enabling environment. Thank you so much. So now I'm going to open it up for our participants in the room. Yes, and I think I will just hand the mic to you, and we'll start right here. Oh, okay, you have one. Okay.
Hi, David Beckman. It occurs to me, just last month, President Biden launched a U.S. national strategy to end hunger and reduce dietary diseases, focused on hunger, nutrition, and health. The goal is to end hunger in America in the United States by 2030 and have a clear impact on dietary diseases. And in the action plan that the U.S. government, the administration released, there are at least some provisions that directly are relevant to the discussion today. Improvements in the WIC program, for example. So I think I'll ask Kathy, you have any brainstorms about how USAID can take advantage of the fact? I mean, it's in one thing that's really a model is that the president of the country convened civil society. They went through several months of all the departments and agencies of the U.S. government thinking about how they could contribute to the president's goal, and they so now the administration is committed to many recommendations across, you know, Department of Transportation, Defense. So it's really a model of intersectoral, and then they also ventured to specify what NGOs and businesses in the U.S. should do to meet that goal of ending hunger and improving nutrition and health by 2030. How might USAID take advantage of the fact that our country's doing something right here? in its dialogue with developing countries?
Well, I would say in writing, they're doing something right. This plan is aspirational, so we need to see that. But I think, yes, it needs to be multi-sectoral, which is why this panel is made the way it is. You'll soon hear from Sean Baker, who is chief nutritionist at USAID. That was a position meant to pull across various strands of USAID, because nutrition is in humanitarian assistance. It's in global health. I hear what you're saying. I agree. And it's a question of how you do it inclusively, but in a focused way to bring everybody together. There are efforts. There's a CEO Council on Nutrition that I have the privilege of co-chairing that's trying to bring groups together to elevate our voice in Congress, which of course influences the White House. And then there's the other side, not what USAID can do, but what can heads of states from other countries do. So looking at, with the upcoming Africa Leaders Summit in Washington, will Africa heads of state pressure the White House to elevate nutrition on that agenda? I think that would go a long way. So I think there are multiple points of leverage that we need to take.
Thank you so much. I saw Dr. Haddad's hand up. It's okay, yeah, Dr. Haddad had his hand up. Okay, maybe after.
Hi, Stephanie Mercy with Farm Journal Foundation. Like to ask to what extent there's an educational component and the interventions that you guys have studied. I read Roger Thoreau's First 1,000 Days several years ago and was struck by the fact that a lot of the families that he followed at the beginning didn't really understand what was a nutritionally appropriate diet for infants. And so I think that the education component has got to be an important part of this discussion.
That could be Will or Manisha.
Yeah.
So I completely agree, and I think it's critical to address education, and we talk about it more under social and behavior change communication, where we look not just at the behaviors, but really try and understand what are the drivers of those behaviors. And like Kate mentioned, it's really important to conduct research to better understand and tailor that to the local context, because it's different even in the US across states, but then more across countries as well. So it's really important to understand whether mothers, caregivers have the knowledge, but more importantly, the confidence, the skills, and then also look at social norms around the spectrum, because it's important not just to influence the practices of mothers, but to make sure that they're supported by families and by societies at large. And more importance, I think governance comes in too, because I think, like we've talked about, the importance of taxes, affordability, all of that plays a role in shaping young children's diets. But I agree that education is key and critical to this effort.
Thank you. So I've gotten this the note that we have just about 5 minutes. So we'll take Dr. Haddad, and then if we have time, we'll take one more online. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, panel and present. thank you, presenters. Thank you, panel. Great session. Great slides. I want them. I've got two pieces of advice, unsolicited advice for USAID. And they both relate to framing, actually. So I think the framing of the issue is really important. So if you don't frame the issue in a problem statement, how do we make safe, nutritious foods more affordable for the most vulnerable, I think you run the risk of doing lots of interesting things in lots of different places, either geographically or within the food system or across different systems, but you run the risk of them not adding up. So if you have a framing that says, how do we make these five key nutritious foods in this country more affordable, then you really begin to draw in the demand side stuff, the supply chain, reducing food loss, getting finance to national food companies. You build in the enabling environment around standards and policies. You bring in school procurement, social protection procurement. You know, you kind of bring it all together in that frame. And you can bring in the health system stuff around supplements. So I think that's really important. And I think the other thing I would like to say is, I think it's really hard to frame that as a complementary feeding initiative, because certainly if you have the commercial sector involved, because I think the commercial sector think it's quite a small market, so they tend to get not as excited about it. So if you framed it as, how do we make these critical ingredients that are really important for lots of things, including complementary feeding, more affordable, then you've got something, I think, a bit more sustainable with greater momentum. Thanks.
Thank you. Excellent comment. I think that's great for thought. So, Carmen, I'm just going to take one more question that we had online, and I don't know if more have come in since I got up, but one that was online earlier from Lisa Sherburne is, there are still small initiatives to have home processing and local markets offer small dried fish as a good addition to young children's food from about 6 months, and feeding young children fish caught. Any thoughts about greater scale for these initiatives, and what role can USAID play in supporting these initiatives? This question was also addressed to Will, but open to, I think others might have a perspective on this as well.
Yeah, I think World Food Prize Week is a great time to remember the prize to Shakuntala Tilstead, who, you know, has been pioneering that particular kind of food. I think the major challenge with dried fish, of course, is that it's not very tasty, so higher income people avoid it, and that does make it a very, very valuable target to reach low-income people. The other food in that category is dark green leafy vegetables. And so that brings in Diana's work now with the Fresh program. So I think that's a really great question and a really good point, and also echoes Lawrence Haddad's point about these are foods that are vitally important for infant feeding, but also many other groups of people.
Okay, thank you. So I think that a lot of what was said earlier sort of, you know, fits into kind of how USAID could support this. I think I've seen a sort of repetition of some key points that I think are relevant. So we are out of time. So I will ask, please, if anybody else has questions and they weren't able to ask, please try and a way to communicate it with us, because we really want the comments and questions. And I think I will hand it over to
Kathy. And Lawrence, a rare occasion, I'm going to correct you. Your recommendations for framing are not unsolicited. It's exactly what we want. And what could be better than to have the chief nutritionist of USAID, Sean Baker, who, among other things, his role at USAID is to guide USAID's investments and engagements with partners to address malnutrition in developing countries. So Sean has been sitting there listening intently and is going to share back what he's heard in terms of top-level recommendations, though we will then take everything that's gone in the chat and all of the discussion today to issue a report of full recommendations. But this is the first kind of synthesis of what word is going to go back to administrator power. Not too much pressure, Sean.
Thank you, Kathy, and I'm now regretting that I agreed to try to summarize such an incredibly nutrient-dense discussion in 6 minutes when I'm still operating with severe jet lag. But more sincerely, a huge vote of thanks to BIFAD for having taken on this subject. I think I tried to frame in 7 big points. So this is not exhaustive, it's just how I've tried to frame what I've heard. I think setting the scene was incredibly sobering. This is an area where globally we certainly are not nourishing our children. So we ask why kids are malnourished. Well, one of the most fundamental reasons was shown very much, we're just not providing them the nutrients they need. And it was also incredibly sobering to see, at least in 10 countries, there's backsliding. And one can only imagine with the current COVID crisis, climate crisis, conflict, et cetera, that backsliding is probably worse and worse for the most vulnerable. At the same time, I'm paid to be an optimist. I've chosen to be an optimist. The power of doing something right is immense. And we don't need to also get everything right everywhere. Every incremental improvement is going to be an improvement. So That to me was, I think it reaffirmed, nobody said this should not be a priority for USAID. So I'm taking away as a big message, this is a strong priority for the agency. Secondly, and related to the optimism, there are a lot of solutions. Where I was struggling is that the solutions, I think, what came across here, there are these pockets of solutions and pockets of light and hope. And I think part of the big challenge right now is moving from those pockets of solutions to how do we really start looking at systemic change at scale where it matters most, and bringing these together. So, and then learning how to do that, so the how science, and then continue really to address those evidence gaps that do remain. So this really has to be framed within what do we know, how do we bring that knowledge together most effectively, what do we still not know, and how do we continue to generate that evidence base. I'm cheating here with my thirst because there are things that are almost internal tensions. There are clear messages about focus and intensity that we need to act now, but we also need to be patient we need to be acting now to have impact, but also building for the medium and long term, because of a lot of what we're trying to aspire to is long-term systems change, which does not happen overnight. So how do we do the right things now while building in the long term? And I do think one of the challenges was mentioned very explicitly, just the way we work from project to project, but we are, as an institution, a lot of continuity. We work with partner institutions that have continuity. So how do we work within the constraints of project timeframes, but with a long-term horizon of what we're trying to achieve? And then very explicit through all of this is that this is indeed an area where the different parts of USAID need to come together, or frame more optimistically, because of our extremely strong presence in health systems, in food systems, in humanitarian assistance, and a growing portfolio in social protection, we actually do have, as a donor agency, such a broad set of resources and connections. We are perhaps not uniquely, but incredibly well placed to try to bring these pieces together. And I do think, and people have mentioned, I think at the get-go, Kathy, you mentioned the soon-to-be signed Global Malnutrition Prevention and Treatment Act, which further codifies this internal coordination we're trying to strive for. I think this is a topic that absolutely exemplifies what is the value of this coordination. Is it coordination for coordination's sake? No, it's really to achieve very concrete outcomes. Fourthly, I really appreciated the discussion, because often when people are speaking to USAID, it's very much on the financing side. What should you be financing? Here I thought it really was also, how do we use other levers of USAID? So obviously, what do we fund is critically important. But then also, how do we use this vast wealth of evidence and knowledge resident in our implementing partner ecosystem and internally? But then there was a huge call to better use our convening power, because so much of this was about the enabling environment, being the regulatory environment, the financing environment, really looking far beyond just what we can fund personally. And I think this aligns extremely well with one of the administrator's priorities, is what she calls progress beyond programs, of looking not just what we are funding and try to do that accounting for directly what we're funding, but how do we use these other levers of our knowledge assets, our convening assets, to drive this level of systemic change. Perhaps what was less explicit in all of this, but certainly was implicit, is that this is also absolutely fundamental to any equity agenda. I think it was striking across the board of how much is driven by lack of ability to access these foods, affordability, accessibility, the time constraints. And the lower you are, the more marginalized you are, either socioeconomically or any other framework, even the harder it is. And then also, I think, Manisha, you came out very strongly how I think in public health nutrition, we've been so guilty of putting it all on the mom's shoulders, right? So to me, for an agency that is so focused on how do we improve or reduce inequities, this is central to that agenda. And then the last, and it's actually where you started out, Kathy, of this cannot really happen without political leadership. And I think, to me, I've been incredibly pleased over the last few months to show how much leadership our administrator, our deputy administrator, have shown on issues of nutrition. We've seen here domestically President Biden having the first White House conference on hunger, nutrition, and health in 50 years. This is an issue that is going to require this level of political leadership. Now, how do we frame this beyond, what's the right language to frame this to create that political momentum? Here we've been very technically focused in some of our terminology, even infant, young child feeding, the nutrient density, et cetera. I don't have solutions to that, but no, nobody, or almost nobody in this world wants to see kids who are malnourished, whom are not getting just the basic nutrients. And I think some of our terminology allows wiggle room for people to dismiss this as overly technically, overly complicated, but it's also incredibly simple. If we're not nourishing our kids, we know they're not going to thrive, they're not going to live, we're not going to have a bright future. And so I think how we take this, and I think, you know, BIFAD, your voice is so incredibly important, of moving this beyond a technical issue to a fundamental moral issue where USAID, in collaboration with its vast ecosystem of implementing partners, partner governments, can really make a systemic change for the good. So in the future, the next report out of UNICEF will not be fed to fail. So thank you very much. And those are my 7 takeaways for right now. But I hold the opportunity to adjust them over time. But thank you so much.
Jay, Lawrence.
Thank you, Sean, for your comments. First, for being here. And I would like to get the name of your travel agent, because they certainly got you here in time. And for your eloquent, informative, and comprehensive summary of the meaningful recommendations for USAID programs and policies to improve the affordability of safe and nutritious foods for young children at this very critical time that we're in. Kathy, I want to thank you as well for your tremendous leadership in organizing today's meeting. Speakers, panelists, thank you for sharing your experience and your evidence-based recommendations. Many thanks also to the World Food Prize Foundation and President Stinson for organizing this year's event. Thanks to those participating in person and on Zoom. Your input and questions made for rich discussion that will set us up well to share actionable recommendations with USAID. As a reminder, we look forward to posting the recording and official minutes of these proceedings on USAID's BIFAD website following this event. Please know that your comments and questions will form part of the official public record and will be considered in BIFAD's recommendations to the USAID administrator. I'd like to thank all of those behind the scenes as well who helped to organize this event, including our BIFAD Executive Director, Clara Coyne,
The BIFAD support team members in the room today, including Senior Counselor Carmen Benson and Program Associate Lena Mohammadi, those hosting the meeting on Zoom, including Tommy Crocker, Carol Chan, Mary Beggs, members of the technical team at CLE Productions, and very, very importantly, the catering team that kept us alert with hot coffee and tea this morning. Thank you all. This concludes the 186th BIFAD public meeting.